And welcome everyone to another space of ours. This is your host Ashutosh. Today I have Utkarsh as a co-host. Utkarsh is a private investor, and we have got Amit Gupta. He has over a decade experience in investment analysis and portfolio management. He has set up research equity desk at Adroit Financial Services across multiple asset classes. And he's regularly quoted by Economic Times, Informus Media, Reuters, and Morningstar. So let's start, guys. Today we'll talk about special situations investing with Amit. So, Amit, thanks for accepting our invite for today's space. I'm sure this is going to be a lot of fun and learnings for our audience. So before we start, I hope everything is all good with COVID and all. So.
Yeah, hi. Welcome, everyone. Thanks, Ashutosh and Utkarsh, for this invite. Pleasure talking about special situation investing. All well with the COVID. Hope everybody else is also doing well, taking precautions. And if you are not vaccinated, get yourself vaccinated. You can continue.
Right. So, Amit, I've heard and a lot of people talking about special situations, and everyone has got their own way of interpreting it. So how do you look at special situations, and, you know, what are basically special situations?
Right. So the basic premise of any special situation investing case is that market participants are irrational. So there will be always situations where stocks are sort of mispriced due to one or multiple reasons. So the reasons could be, you know, the business cycle is out of favor. There have been past corporate governance issues with the company. So people, you know, investors don't want to touch that company. Maybe there is too much of government interference happening, or the payments not coming from the government. So in that way, there is a contrarian approach to where you try to buy the companies at a turnaround stage. On top of that, another way of playing the special situation is where it is event-based investing. So whether it is a demerger happening in a company, or amalgamations of subsidiaries happening, whether there is a delisting, or maybe a special dividend is coming, or maybe there is a stake sale by the company, or a takeover. So these kind of event-based special situations is also there. Why does all these mergers and demergers and events happen? You know, sometimes the reasons are very internal to a company. So a company will not demerge its subsidiaries to avoid giving up control. So in that case, maybe a change of the management could be the trigger to buy that company. Or maybe a private equity buying a stake in a company can cause shareholders value unlocking. And, you know, then if the companies are, let's say, listed separately, then most of the investors will find intrinsic value to be, you know, worth investing in these kind of companies. So, yeah, there could be multiple reasons of why special situation investing can be done. But a primary reason is that, you know, you need to find value in the company at the sort of a turnaround stage.
Yeah, thanks a lot for coming for this space, Amitji. It's a pleasure to host you. So why do you think this special situations can outperform the market or produce alpha? What are the factors that an investor should look for?
So, the aim is to generate alpha, beat the benchmark. And if done correctly, if is the key operative word here. If done correctly, then it can help to, you know, create sort of an alpha in the market. So we look into those sort of investment that we can find in the listed space that displays some sort of characteristic of, having a catalyst event with them. So it could be, you know, spin-off, directors change, management change, restructuring, etc. The basic premise is that, it needs to have that event within the company happening. And anything that we believe will move price to value, basically. So, obviously there are more than 5,000 stocks listed in the company. There are a lot of stocks around where people can choose from. At any point of time, you know, there could be close to 100 stocks where the special situation events are happening. But ultimately, you know, the trigger is critical to analyze and research. And a sort of analysis of the opportunity cost needs to be made before you actually put in a position for any of the stocks. Because, you know, ultimately what is going to move the stocks is that catalyst event. If that catalyst event is happening at the right time, then you can sort of generate an alpha within a relatively shorter period of time as compared to, let's say, a value investing or, you know, other kind of investing.
Right. So, Amit, I see that you have categorized or broadly classified different types of this plays, like special situation plays into like corporate actions or regulatory policy changes, something like that. So can you, you know, talk more about it? How have you classified it and like what kind of opportunities are present in each one of them?
Maybe. Right. So basically how we divide our portfolio, special situation portfolios, is into three categories. One is the event-based category, which sort of forms the bulk of the portfolio, close to 40 to 45% of the portfolio, where there is a certain corporate action which is happening. So like I said before, this corporate action could be, you know, a merger, demerger, or delisting, or maybe a buyback happening, or a special dividend which is happening, or a takeover is happening, or stake sale is happening, amalgamation of subsidiaries is happening. So these kind of events where we like to play in the market. Second could be, in the way there are some dramatical regulatory or policy changes which happens, which sort of triggers the sector and, you know, makes everyone take notice of that particular sector because of the regulatory changes which are happening. So, for example, in past couple of years, we have a new ethanol policy coming up. We had an EV policy which is accelerating. There are a lot of work which is done for the water theme also. So these kind of new theme-based innovations and which are driven by regulatory change, that could be there. And the third could be a little bit longer in the horizon where, you know, there is a totally a new theme is coming up. And apart from that, you know, there is a technology-led disruption also happening in that. So the third level is, you know, part of that special situation. But what also happens is sometimes the stock is going under multiple levels of special situation. So there is a corporate action also happening. There is a regulatory changes which is also happening. And then there is a theme-based innovation which is also happening. So a stock can be, you know, part of the portfolio for just not the period for which the corporate action is happening, but for a slightly longer period of time. So we try and work our portfolio for these three broader levels of themes and try and see, you know, how we can fit them into the portfolio so that, you know, a better return can be generated for the investors.
So, Amitji, a follow-up question on that. It's often said that most of the acquisition fails, right? You were talking about the corporate action and the management change. And a lot of demerger also get prolonged for a long periods of time. So how do you take these situations into account?
Right. So that's where the you know, basically the bigger question of opportunity cost comes into play. You don't want to be invested in a company where the, you know, demerger or any of the special situation takes inordinately very long periods of time. In my experience, the good management starts guiding for these kind of special situations months and quarters in advance. So, you know, a lot of when you'll read the exchange notifications, you'll probably get an idea, you know, that this is the kind of special situation which might be coming, you know, on board. So the way you basically invest is that you read these exchange filings that nobody really would go in that kind of a detail And that sort of becomes kind of your advantage. You read them day in and day out. And I think a lot of these things are complex at first blush, but once you sort of understand the mechanics of them, then they becomes a little simpler. So you are right, you know, you don't want to be invested in sort of companies which will take very, very long period of time to get demerged. So that's where the question of opportunity cost comes. And you want to time your entry and exits into these companies very well. So that's where your research comes in, you know. It's also true that, you know, a lot of acquisition fails. They do not actually materialize at all. But that's where, you know, you need to take a call. Yeah, whether this, if this event does not happen, then also you're not losing out on too much of your capital. You may lose the upside and you may incur the opportunity cost, but at least you're not, losing too much of your capital into that. So I think doing proper research before, you know, putting into a position in a special situation, that becomes imperative.
All right. So Amit, how do you, exit these stocks when the acquisition or the demerger that was going to happen doesn't happen? So do you have a time-based stop or do you constantly look at the management's commentary and, you know, try to figure it out that, yeah, they are kind of deviating from what they were trying to do?
Yeah. So in that, the management guidance is, very critical for us. A good special situation event will be where we are, guided by the management, why a certain decision is taken. Because you need to understand that every special situation has a capital allocation decision also behind it. You don't want to be into a company where the whole structure is getting broken down just because a special situation is happening. And also you need to, take into account how the market is reacting to it. So, for example, a few years ago, our logistic company's CEO and MD, he decided to venture out into airlines business. And even though it was his personal money, but the market did not really took it very kindly. And there was all sort of a 40% drop within like a couple of days. So I think from that point of view, also it becomes very critical. Again, you also need to see when you are analyzing these kind of companies, how the cash flows are working out. If let's say in the case of a merger, you need to see whether that new company which is getting merged, how it fits into the existing company. When you're evaluating that, you need to see how cash flows will enhance the balance sheet and the P&L. Whether the cash flows will be straight away coming in, or will they take, one or two quarters to show up in the balance in the balance sheet, in the cash flow statement. What is going to be the free cash flow generation from this? How it will enhance the profitability and so on. In addition, you also need to see, how this company fits into the culture. So, for example, Kotak bought ING Vaishya a few years ago. That was one of the biggest banking transactions at that point of time. But it took almost like 2.5 to 3 years for the full integration to happen. Because culturally, these both were very different companies and it took a little bit of time to adjust for everyone. So there is a checklist, where you need to see the whole... how it is fitting into all these parameters, and then only you can take a decision whether to invest into the company or not.
So Amitji, what kind of risk management you do in your portfolio of special situations? What kind of weightage you are giving allocation? Could you like share some light on that?
So we are not very ultra diversified, portfolios which like having 40-50 stocks. R is a much more 20-25 stocks. Our upper cap is currently at 25 stocks. We are, I think, in small case portfolio we have about 23 stocks currently in the portfolio, and even in the non-small case ones the limit is 25. So that's why how we structure the portfolio. Usually, as far as the allocations are concerned, we don't buy an initial allocation which is less than 3% of the portfolio. We believe that anything less than 3%, it's just not worth having it in the portfolio. I mean, there's nothing wrong in having a less than 3% allocation, but I'll rather have a allocation which is substantial in terms of returns if it works out well in that sense. So that's how we structure the portfolio. Basically, 3% the minimum allocation, and maximum allocation between could be anywhere between 7 to 10%. So that gives us a little bit of flexibility if we want to take a profit booking call or a cash call at any point of time in the market cycle. Like we did in August this year, we did a little bit in October as well. So that's how we do. And as far as the the risk management is concerned, we also try and evaluate the management integrity and how they are guiding for the management. If we feel that management is guiding in a way that that is consistent with our investment thesis, then we'll continue with that investment for that. But our basic risk management is that when we are putting a position into a special situation portfolio, then we always invert and ask, what if this does not work? How much capital we are going to lose if this special situation does not work? So that gives us fair idea, how much position size we want to have it, whether we want to have it at the minimum of 3%. Or whether we want to have it at a much higher allocation of, let's say, 5% or 7% of the portfolio. Yeah.
Right. So, Amit, we know that you manage a huge amount of corpus, and you said you take a 8 to 10% kind of allocation to a stock, and most of these special situations are in small cap to mid cap kind of space. So how do you manage the illiquidity and, not get stuck into it?
I always say that special situations are cap agnostic portfolios. We go wherever the special situation takes us. So it's not that, we are buying only small caps or we are buying only the large caps. If the special situation is there in large caps also, we are happy to take it. It's just that at this point of time, there are more opportunities in the small case space, small cap space. So the benchmark is, against the small cap index. But if you look at our portfolios, most of them have 25 to 30% stock allocation, which is actually in large caps and which are in F&O segment. So they are fairly liquid. You can easily entry and exit out of them. If we feel that, certain stocks which are very, which are sort of a little bit illiquid and we may face issue if we have to take an exit and everybody is coming at the same time to sell the stock, then we'll make sure that the allocation is not more than 3% in the portfolio. So fortunately, nothing of that sort has happened. We have taken a couple of exits in the past 3 months or so in the small cap space, but the liquidity has been sufficient enough to get an exit. But when you're putting a weightage to that stock, then liquidity is a very critical parameter especially in the small cap space.
So Amitji, could you share any recent bet of yours which went to south, which did not perform as you expected, the story did not play out as you expected?
So I think, probably not recent, but like a couple of years ago, we had this, we played this demo of Green Panel. And even though management was guiding the approval for a really long period of time to come through. So I'll just touch a little bit upon, the process of approvals, which comes into these kind of special situations and why sometimes it takes a lot of time. So, for example, a company is undergoing, let's say, demerger. So they need to do a lot of documentation procedure and they need to get an approvals. So they need to apply to stock exchanges, NSE, NBSE. They need to apply to SEBI. They need to get shareholders' approval, they need to get a creditor approval. Similarly, they need to apply to the lot of approvals which needs to happen, stock exchanges, SEBI, the shareholders, the creditor approvals, and then you need to get approvals from the respective benches of NCLT. So if a company, let's say, is present in two cities, Bombay and Calcutta, they need to get approvals from both the cities' NCLTs. And then there are a lot of approvals from, sector-specific entities as well. So, for example, if a company is in insurance, then you need to get an IRDAI approval. If it's a financial entity, then you also need to get an approval from RBI. Similarly, if it's like, let's say, AMC, then you need to get an approval from AMFI, Association of Mutual Funds. So there is a lot of, public documentation which happens, and a lot of approvals also happens. So in the case of Green Plan, Green Merger, firstly, those approvals took a lot of time. They took almost 1 year. Then the demerger happened with the Green Panel being listed 2-3 months after the X date. And then the COVID happened. So, the stock really went down. The markets obviously crashed. The real estate cycle got pushed. There were obviously mobility restrictions last year for almost four months. So the company operations also took a hit. So that gave us a sort of a lot of pain at that point of time. We were at one point of time, we were almost like 40% down on these investments. But eventually it worked out well in that sense. A similar thing also happened with the demerger of HSIL and SHIL, so Money Home Innovation and Hindustan Sanitary Ware. So sometimes, the investment can go bad for like temporary reasons, which are not really in your control or even the company's control. But if your basic investment premises remains the same, then you hold the company. Otherwise, you'll take a exit into that company. So, those two demerger situations, they eventually turn out to be well, but they gave us a lot of pain for the interim 14-15 months.
And any bet, any allocation that went like really smooth as expected in a time frame that you had initially envisaged?
So I think currently, this is not a financial, investment advice. We still hold the stock. So we have been invested in GMR Infra for past 2.5 years. And we bought it at like around when it was close to 15 rupees and now almost 3x. And finally, the demerger is happening. So that is one situation where we felt that market was not identifying the changes which has already happened in the company in the last 5 years. Because GMR Infra had a lot of businesses and still has a businesses in EPC segment and the power space. But they, 2.5 years ago, almost 3 years ago, they made a very categorical presentation which says that they want to be the pure airport company of in India, and they want to exit all the businesses. So I think the exiting of the businesses is still in the process. Obviously, again, the COVID happened, so things obviously got postponed a little bit. That is something, which was bought again, tied, I would say, against the market sentiment of having a contrarian approach. And that has sort of worked well so far. We are still invested in it and we continue to...
That played really well, I guess, with the GMR Infra from 15 to 45 means that must be a great trade, I guess.
Yeah, I think, till the investment thesis is on, we'll continue to probably hold it. We think that the aviation story in India is just beginning, and with this Udaan scheme coming in and a lot more airports being opened in the next few years, this story will, remain in place. Also, GMR is doing a lot of international airports as well. They recently did a joint venture in Indonesia as well. So, it has worked out well, and we continue to hold it. Let's see how it moves post the demerger.
Okay, so what are you looking at? Like, no financial advice, just for the sake of discussion.
Right. I mean, looking at in like stock specific.
Yeah, you're on GMR. Like, what are you looking at in GMR? So, what are you expecting after the demerger? Or you have any targets in mind? Or
No, not targets in mind. But my sense is that it's a 5 to 10 year story. See, our basic premise of buying that, apart from playing out the special situation, which is that they are going to chuck out the not so profitable portions of the company, which is the power and the EPC. So after the demerger also, we may not be very keen to hold on to that demerged entity, which is going to get listed. But we are very happy to hold the airport company. So our basic premise is that this company, you know, with the aviation sector opening up in India, with the Udaan scheme coming in, you'll have around close to, 70, 80 new airports in the next 10 years in India. And GMR Infra will, indirectly benefit from that. Apart from that, now they have done joint ventures in foreign countries. Recently they did a joint venture in Indonesian airport. They're also part of Philippines airport. And then they have got foreign partners in Group ADP, France-based. They will have a joint venture with them, and that will open up European sectors for them. So basically, GMR makes money every time anyone lands on the airport as an airport fees. Plus, they make money from the rentals as well. So this is a booming space. As more and more airports come in, you'll see more and more people traveling through the airlines, and the story can continue to compound for the next few years at least. That is the visibility currently. So yeah, right. So it's a basically a multiple play. It's a sectoral play also. It's a demerger situation also. It's a new management also, in a way that ADP Group has now 49% of stake in it.
Right, yeah.
Amit, please share some resources that people can read, books, few books, to explore more on special situation investing.
Yeah, and few screeners, or how do you find, do you directly scan BSE list, or how do you look at, get ideas maybe?
I think as far as the books are concerned, one of the best books I have read on special situation is by this American investor, Green Ballot. There is a yellow book which is called You Can Be a Stock Market Genius. So Green Ballot has written three books. I think one is a red book, one is called Blue Book, and one is the yellow book. So the yellow one is actually for the special situations. So he goes through all of these scenarios and how you can find them. So I know that's a reasonably complicated book for the freshers, so not really recommended for them. But anyone who wants to take a special situation investing seriously, I would say it's an essential starting point. Apart from that, you have these 5-6 books by Morris Schaller, which is also a good starting point. Anybody who wants to read more about special situation investing. And apart from that, if you read some of the Warren Buffett's letters in the late 50s and the 60s, they have a lot of examples, of special situation investing happening at that point of time. Obviously, the dynamics of that investing has completely changed now. But if somebody wants to read the basics, they could go through the letters from the late 50s and 60s as well. As well as the screener is concerned, I find the best screener is actually the most simple, which is the exchange notifications. So you basically read them, and over a period of time, that becomes a kind of your advantage. So you read them day in and day out, and they may seem very complex at first, read, but once you sort of understand the mechanics of them, they are actually very simple. So there is a steep learning curve initially, but over a period of time, it just gets a little easier. So I had a when I started special situation investing close to 10, 12 years ago, I had an advantage that one of my childhood friends, he was a lawyer and he used to do a lot of these M&As and spin-offs and demergers for almost 7 to 10 years of his professional career in the beginning. So that gave me a sort of insight on how to tackle all of these. So I'm you know always looking for those things when the special situation hasn't manifested yet. Sometimes it's a bit of a time when you dig deep to see what is management is up to. Cases they haven't really declared it, but you can see it is coming because you know the stocks are so much undervalued. So maybe they have got cash on the books, they are thinking about it, or they are typically being sort of good in the past, but not able to do a particular special situation. So yeah, I think exchange notifications and few of these books are a good starting point to understand special situation investing. And then I also write very often, so yeah, people can read that as well.
Right. Actually, I'm a big follower of that. Before that, if any one of you would like to, if doesn't want to do the heavy work and always check Amit's work on his small case, I've shared the link in the above. Okay, and yeah. So Amit, I actually read a lot of your newsletters and the thread that you have curated kind of these charts. So you post one chart daily, or you curate a list of Twitter thread of charts, right?
Right. So I actually used to do that for, I did it for like a couple of years, I think from 2019 to 2021, April. I did it, but then realized
Right,
that,
I've yeah.
yeah, so I realized that Twitter was actually cutting the threads were too long. And because I was writing it for almost 2 years, it had sort of like 700 tweets in that particular thread. So then from April 21, I moved to a weekly newsletter. So that newsletter goes out usually on Monday morning before Meta, which contains 10, 10 charts, which I feel is relevant to our investment strategy and our investment thesis and what we feel is happening in the market, which is important. So yeah, that's how I like to share knowledge a little bit in the form of that weekly, the form of charts, because I think charts are like visually represented, and anybody who's very new to the market can also sort of understand what will happen and what trend is going to show up.
Right. So actually, I'm a big follower of your newsletter, and you post different links. So I guess you got two letters. One contains different links for the resources, and the second one is for the charts, and both of them are great. So I just would like to thank you for that. I have been following this since like 2019, the day you started this.
Okay,
And I
thank you
just
for your
really
kind
appreciate
words and
yeah.
following.
Yeah, I really appreciate it. So I have pinned that in the spaces. Please everyone go check out the links and subscribe. It's free of cost. You can subscribe and get the content in your mail, and you can check it out. He curates a list of 10 15 links, but 5 to 10 links every week, and they contain resources from some of the best people out there, and it's just great having different views, opinions, and learning something different every week. So yeah.
So yeah, I mean,
Will now probably yeah.
so yeah, I mean,
Yeah, Amit.
actually these are like self notes, you can say. So I try and curate the links so that you know, whenever I want to go back and you know read my notes, it becomes a little easy. But because I'm doing it for myself also, I better share it for the larger investing community as well. So that newsletter goes out usually every Friday post market hours.
Right, so helps us and reduces our time to search for these contents. We get it like made. Thanks everyone for joining in. It has been a pleasure talking to you all. We'll probably host us spaces soon again, and sorry for the glitches that we had. It was really painful for us, and just ask your questions there and we'll get them answered. Okay, chalo, thank you everyone. Have a great evening. Bye bye, take care.